Thank you. Lord, by you, our brother and sister. broken, Father. We render those words powerless. I thank you, Father, that you have called us to be a holy people. And when I said of anything that was less than that, I came out of our mouths. And we forgive, Father, any of those who have spoken things against us. And Lord, I just thank you that as we allow you to cleanse us, and I went back and I was like, what are you talking about? break-ins in your life and what you're doing and what your community is doing and what your nation is doing. He said, I am going to interrupt the status quo. I am breaking in. I'm going to break in your nation. And we're just like, whoa, because it carried an element of surprise. Just when that guy knocked on the door, you know, and yet it was an interruption. And the Lord is like, excuse me? And it has that suddenness. And so I finally got it. And it's like a sudden invasion of his presence. And so, this is like, shoot. So on that word from the Lord, I want us to take up an offering. Because when the Lord speaks something, I want us to sow into it. You know? And so I want us to sow into this with anticipation, with expectation. I tell you tonight, God wants to break in. He's going to interrupt. He's going to come, and he's going to speak to our brother. He already spoke to the worship. But we have to be ready. So if you guys want to start taking up the collection, but Lord, just impress upon our hearts that we want to sow, we want to speak into what you have just spoken. And far be it from us not to allow you to come with us suddenly and to break into whatever we're doing whenever you want. And I just receive that sudden invasion of your presence in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Precious husband, could you bring me my purse? Because my offering too much. Yeah, that little one. Thank you. We want you. Thanks, Lord. Every morning, I say, I want to be part of that. It's really good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, I just thank you that you're speaking into our heart and as we speak into this word and we're anticipating and expecting for that sudden invasion of your presence. I just thank you that we've given and we've given from our heart with a happy expectation. Amen.
Lord, we bring this offering up to you. To bless the ministry who has been with us and has stepped through the door. You bless it fully, and graciously in Jesus' name. It was my privilege to get to meet Mary and Bibi in Cuba and spend some time with them and got to be friends. It's neat. In our ministry, we have so many wonderful friends all over the United States and some in other parts of the world too. Praise God. And it is another thing that we've got to know. And Cuba was awesome. I know they told you that. So I don't want to talk about it. Praise God. Well, suddenly. Yeah, amen. God does something suddenly at times like that. This is Christmas time. How many remember the scriptures? And then suddenly, there was a host of angels declaring his word. And there are going to be things that are going to be sudden in these last days. And 2012 is going to be some kind of awesome year. Different ways too. We need to be prepared mentally, spiritually, physically. For the last 4 years, God has been giving me more dreams, more blessed visions of what's happening, what He's doing, and what's coming. And you know, when He said, as the days of Noah, so shall it be when He comes back, that we need to see this apparel up there. And there's a lot of things happening right now that we don't even know about. It's happening. One of the things I see, the Lord showed me, there's going to be a push for group or water medicine. And it's going to be through an economic class that's coming. And I believe, though, that's not just going to happen. It's not time for this to happen yet because the harvest is not coming. And God's got a heart on the harvest. And that's where our heart needs to be. No matter what's happening, we want to know what God's plan is. When Noah prepared an ark, the Bible says God told him to do that with his plan for what was coming. God just didn't say, Noah's going to be a flood. He said, what do I do? You learn how to swim. I mean, that wouldn't have worked. Yeah. So he told him to build a boat. And they probably didn't know what a boat was. I don't know if they did or not. But, you know, God had a plan, didn't he? And a lot of times people say, well, I don't care what's coming, you know, God take care of it. Well, what is God's plan? You've got to know what God's plan is. And knowing God's plan means you're hearing from God. And it's so, so important right now to hear from God. If you're not hearing from God, you need to pray more. Amen. When you study faith, you know, faith comes by hearing. And hearing by the word. Well, when I was a kid, my mom said a lot of things to me. I didn't hear. My teacher said a lot of things I didn't hear. I didn't want to hear. I had an ear not to hear. It's called selective hearing. And when it says in that faith chapter 11, it says, God's reward of those that diligently seek Him. I have learned that seeking God makes you an ear to hear. I have stored the Word of God and it just ain't right. You know, nothing was happening. I know what it means to move in the Spirit. I know what it means. I remember several years ago, we were standing at Deacon Rose, and I got sick after the service. I got sick with that bad moment. I know it wasn't Rose's good cooking because nobody else got sick. But I was so sick, and I went and I prayed all night in front of the pool. I was there anyway. I was going to pray. And I mean, I prayed all night. I was confessing the word, believing God, seeking God. You know, and I didn't get any better. And morning came, and joy didn't show up. And I remember God told me, He says, get big. He prayed for you. And so I said, I lived there. My wife slept all night. She usually didn't sleep that good. But she slept all through this, all through my suffering. And, I wouldn't even do this job. Job had comfort. But in the morning, you know, and God showed me what was going to happen. I called all the people who were living there in the basement. And I had a vision. I saw Dick coming down, saying, what's wrong, Bill? I told him. He started walking back toward the room. And then suddenly, he turned to me and says, get up in Jesus' name. And he did anything. Did all that, and when I got up, Lord told me to start dancing. So as soon as I stood up, I started dancing for the Lord, and I went up in the Spirit. I felt like I didn't want to open my eyes because I thought I was still being in the den of the basement. And I felt like I was going up above the house and everything, but I knew I wasn't, but I felt like in the Spirit. And all the pain, all the suffering, all the stomach ache, all that just basically was gone. And I said, Lord, I'm going to just stay here. I knew how Peter felt in the Mount of Transfiguration. I'm just going to stay here. I won't build a new tabernacle. I'm just going to stay here. Well, I know that it needs to be in the Spirit. And I've prayed and sought God at times. And you think, well, why doesn't the answer come? Why doesn't the manifestation come? And I found that if you just keep seeking God, all of a sudden, that word from the standing room that was so hard, it's like, well, this is the word, I've never had faith. Well, faith comes by hearing. And you have to have selective hearing. I only hear from God. And Jesus said, if your eye be singing, your whole being will be full of His light. And I believe what that means is there are times you have to really put your eye on the Lord and keep it there long enough until you know what He is saying. Amen. Hallelujah. We are going through a period right now that God is getting us ready for an outpouring of His Mr. Chair, we grew up in one place. I've had the gift of faith benefits. Now, I've heard of it. I've seen it operate. Well, I guess I've seen it operate. I saw it through writings of Smith Wigglesworth. Probably the gift of faith operating more than any other man since, we've only been about it. And I was in this church, and all of a sudden the Lord says, I'm going to give you something, and I want you to give it to so-and-so in the church. And I didn't know this person, according to that. And all of a sudden, this life, this gift of some kind of glorious thing from God came, and I felt it come into me. And I said, lady, back over here, and tell me what you're supposed to do. I said, come here. God told me to give you something. And I said, in the name of Jesus, see it. And the power of God hit her. I never felt the power of God come out. And then, later on the service, Lord says, I want you to bless people who are struggling financially. I'm going to break what the devil's doing, and I'm going to impart to them the spirit of prosperity. I want to have somebody else pray me go down and receive that. And I felt that it came into me. It was a heavenly thing that came into me. And so these people came down, and we had a whole fun. Church filled up. And when I spoke it, people hit the floor. One guy jumped up off the ground and up in the air and hit the floor. And I'm going, did I say that? And the Lord said, that's the gift of faith. To declare, to speak things, to release them. And then it happened again. It happened 3 times in that service. And the Lord said, I'm going to begin to do this more and more as I can trust my people. So here's the thing. Can God trust us with this power? I asked Lord one time, I said, how much power can I have? He said, as much as I can trust you with. I said, how much is that? He said, how much do you have? I said, let's go on to a different subject. God does have a sense of humor, but he's very truthful. Amen? Wow, things are happening very quickly now. God gave me a word recently. And Dick Richard said, what is it? I said, I can't tell you. It's a word God showed me about a president and what he's going to do with it. And I started to share it in the church. We were at the Lord said, I can't share this. I said, why? He said, because it's special. Like everybody. Amen. So pray for him. It's getting short. The time is getting very, very short. There are things coming to our country that God needs to write leaders in place. Amen. So that our country will not go the wrong way. The church is the only hope for America. There's no hope for America. America has gone too far. We shed too much innocent blood with abortion. But God will hold back the judgment because of his people. Amen. If we will do the job he wants us to do. Amen. God showed that even now the judgment is being held back. Even now, there are things that would have happened that he has held back purposely because he's been able to find a remnant of people to pray. Amen. I want to read you some statistics. I want to share some things that, we don't realize how closely related all things are. For instance, I know Einstein had his theory of relativity, but he was seeing something. You see, everything was created by the Word of God. So God has imparted of himself into everything he's created. Think about that. So anytime the things on this earth get outside of that Word, then his creation is going to respond. And God took me back to the scripture and showed me that all the judgments that come usually are through the earth. God told Noah, I will use the earth to destroy mankind. Wow. And Ezekiel, he called, he said, I have four severe judgments. Famine, pestilence, the wild beast, and the sword. Three of those were the earth, rising up against mankind. And God told him, he said, son, all of creation, remember the Apostle Paul said, all of creation is groaning and preparing in pain. Why? Because of the load of sin that's on it. And it reaches a point where the earth itself will rise up to purge itself. Amen. And that's what's happening right now. The foundations of the earth are shaking. Huh? They didn't even know they had a fault. An earthquake fault line in Virginia. Virginia's where I'm from. We never knew there was one there. We thought these those were set. That only happened in California. An earthquake that went through Washington, D.C. cracked the foundation of the Washington Memorial. Oh, did God speak to me louder than that? He was our first president. You know, when he was inaugurated at Ground Zero. Yeah. The federal building is still there. It was inaugurated at their Ground Zero in New York. Just across from that, and I'm going to share some more of this tomorrow night. He walked across from there, from the federal building, and walked over to a little church called St. Paul's Chapel, and there he knelt down and prayed over our nation. And there's a statue of him there on his knees with his hands folded together. Pray. He said, if a nation ever departs from the laws of God, then it will cease to carry its presence. I mean, we know that's the truth, isn't it? Amen. And see, America's been great because it's had a morality to its base. But as we got away from that, America began to crumble. Amen. But darkness, I had a vision this year of America, and I saw pockets of darkness over it. The darkest place was Washington, D.C. I said, God, how can anybody function now? He said, they're not. He said, the problems you have, they don't have a fix. And he said, and what they do will make them worse. You know, you ever heard of a person going to the doctor and had sickness and the doctor didn't make him sick? And that's happened. Not me, not real often, thank God. But that's what's happening right now. America's sick. And what our leaders are doing is making it worse. Because there's no spiritual guidance. There's no spiritual guidance. Now, the earth is going to manifest rebellion. It's going to rebel against the sin that's on it. It's already doing it. Let me read you some things here. Look, we already saw the Arizona dust storm that had back in the day. Anybody see that? You ought to go on YouTube and type in Arizona dust storm. This was back in June of this year. It was so black and thick, it was thousands of feet high in the air, and it just swept over the whole city. Darkness. February 22nd, 2011, there was an earthquake in New Zealand. Very big earthquake there. We saw a great earthquake. March 11, 2011, Japan had a great earthquake overnight on the Richter scale. March 20, 2011, there were 16 quakes over a 14-hour period on March 20th. 9 earthquakes on the 19th and 11 on the 17th, which was all in March. July 15th, 2011, Chile had the great earthquake. You remember that? That's one that moved the earth on its axis. Some of you know they had to change the numbers on the inner runways because of this. Because your earth is moving, it's tilted more. You know what global warming is? It's the devil's doctrine, or system, is the doctrine of the devil as the world begins to react to sin. There's going to be changes in the weather. I'm talking about, you talk about extremes. And the devil wants something to blame it on. Are you listening to me? It's not our cause that are causing it, it's sin. Come on now. And the devil knows what's coming. He knows the earth is going to shake. He can read the Bible. Bible too. And Jesus says, I've got to have a doctrine so I can put this on so people won't think it's God's judgment. Oh, no. He's smart, isn't he? He thinks ahead.
No.
Spain had an earthquake May the 11th of this year. Portugal, thousands of dead squid washed up on their shores. New Zealand, thousands of dead whales washed up on their shores. Tens of thousands of dead fish washed up in Rio de Janeiro. On the Arkansas River, tens of thousands of dead fish washed up on the shores. In BB, Arkansas, dead birds or birds fell from the sky. Dead. Let me just stop that. They wanted to tell us it was fireworks day. Yeah, and I told them, I said, well, yeah, how about that bridge you got in yourself? Dead fish washed up on the shores of California. In the United Kingdom, dead fish washed up dead. Russia had a plague of locusts in June of this year. Also, I'm telling you, you can look it up a little bit. China had a plague of grasshoppers. Sound like we're living in Egypt, not before the Exodus. Southeastern Australia had millions and billions of locusts, plague of locusts, and also eagles. Greece had a plague of frogs. They weren't real big. I saw them. They were real big things hopping. There were so many you couldn't walk without stepping on them. That was in April of this year. Australia had flooding that was so large it covered areas in Australia the size of France. Chile had a volcano eruption in June this year, largest earthquake in history. Category 5 hit Australia. Namibia, Africa had snow in the desert in June. You say, well, that's extreme. Absolutely extreme. One of the things the Lord told me 3 years ago, he said, son, you're going to see extremes in everything. You're going to see extremes in weather, politics, things people believe. I mean, people witness crazy stuff happens. And what's happening? Darkness is coming here. But we have the promise that God's light will rise in us. Hallelujah. What kingdom do we operate in? The kingdom of heaven. What if the kingdom of the kingdoms of the world began to crumble? Will God's kingdom crumble? Whose kingdom are we operating in? If the kingdoms of the world begin to crumble, we find that whose kingdom we're operating in. Come on, amen. Yeah, it's kind of like, you know, we're operating in healing, and when you get really sick, and you find out if you really believe in healing. Hello? If you have your Bible, go ahead and open, if you would, to the book of Genesis, chapter 18. We'll look at just a few things. The Lord's been showing me there's going to be real soon a huge, large, maybe probably the largest transfer of wealth ever in the history of mankind. It's coming. I saw paper wealth. I don't know if you know when I say paper wealth, what that means. Things are on paper. Stocks, bonds, things like that. I saw them disappear. I saw people that did not know God commit suicide because of it. Maybe you work all your life and you got a nice 401k and all of a sudden the economy crashes and the value of things goes way down and they send you your 401k and now you don't have anything. It's already happened in a small measure. I talked to a man out in Lamesa, Texas, came over to our travel trailer where we were there preaching holding the meeting. He said, Brother Ford, he says, I'm 72, I've had to go back to work. I said, why? He said all of my retirement was in GM. He lost everything. That suddenly, does he know God blessed him? He's got a pretty good job. It's not a strenuous job. He doesn't have to get out of his field. Praise God. God was good. Amen. God will take care of his people if we trust him. Praise the Lord. Look at Genesis chapter 18. Here's the story of Abraham, what an awesome man of God. He knew some things about God that we need to know. Now, before I read this first verse, now we're going to start 16. Let me tell you just a little bit what's happening. God had given Abraham a promise. He said, I'm going to give you a son, a promise. God likes to let the natural realm get to where it's impossible. And then he steps in and does it that way. You can't say, oh, well, you know, that was like a coincidence. No. God shows his power. Amen. So God comes to assure Abraham. And I don't know if Abraham was getting to the point of, well, I wonder if God's going to do this or not. But anyway, God encouraged him. And he came in three persons. Perhaps three angelic beings. And we know God is a family. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Now, he gets up to leave because he's going to Sodom and Gomorrah. Verse number 16. The men rose from there and looked toward Sodom, and Abraham went with them to send them on the way. And the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham what I am doing? I like that. I had the Lord tell me something one time. I said, Lord, why don't you show me that? He said, because you're my friend. And he said, stay that way. Because we have a tendency to let the world creep in on us and don't realize it, don't we? You know, I'm always, you know, something like God's always having to say, hey, you get too much of the world on you. Push it out of your life. Put your eyes back on you. I don't like to go through those periods of not hearing you. The most fun times in my walk with God is when he talks to me. But when he says something, you can count on it. You go to the bank. Amen. You don't have to ask anybody else. I mean, you are good witness. Amen. But when God speaks, and we know it's God, man, we go with it. Amen. Hallelujah. He's going to do it. He'll come through. He always will. He always does. Abraham was called the friend of God, wasn't he? So God will always share with his friends what he's doing. Jesus said, up until now, I've called the servants, but now I'm going to call the friends. Because the servant does not know what his master is doing. Now, we make ourselves servants to God, to serve him, but God calls us friends. Intimate relationship with him. Amen? That's what Abraham had. Since Abraham should really become a great mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. I mean, that's still true today. That's why the devil hates the Jews so much because of this one right here. They're always accused of stealing the wealth. Hitler blamed the Jews for stealing the wealth from his country. He did, didn't he? And that was his reason he got to stone him. The devil always comes up with a reason, doesn't he? You know, I was listening, you know, some of the things that Demagogue said about Israel. You know, how he downgrades them, he doesn't even believe in the Holocaust. And you know, what if we as Americans said, well, we don't like Iran. We think we need to just wipe Iran off the map. Wouldn't the world be outraged? Sure they would, or any country. If we didn't, we said, well, we don't like this country, that country. Well, what's different with the Jews? Why is there such hatred for the Jews? Because of this promise right here to this man. I don't care even if the Jews aren't serving God right now. God gave a promise to this man. Amen. And he gave that land to the Jews. And you watch what happens very, very soon. Because when that happens, not very soon, you're going to crash. Now, I'll show you. was in an empty tomb last year when we were in Indiana. Came into church, I was by myself, came into the church, took a bucket. He said, go to your Bible. I'm going to show you what's coming. Went up to my Bible, opened it up, and shaking my belief. He said, God, how do I know what there is? And I said, oh. And I just said, he says, he will keep the way of the Lord and do righteousness and justice. The Lord may bring to Abraham what he has spoken in Numbers 20. The Lord says, because the outcry, circle the word outcry, against Sodom and Gomorrah is great, because their sin is great, God will go down now and see what they have done, or if they have done altogether according to the outcry there is again against it, that is come to me, if not, I will know it. What's the outcry? Now, I don't have someone else to explain this, but I'm going to kind of give it to you in a nutshell. Is that good? All right. The earth itself, we know, has life in it. Go see the ground here, grow vegetables through it. Amen? I mean, you look at a handful of dirt. You say, how in the world can that make anything? It's got life in it. The earth is alive. Jesus said, rocks cry out. Come on, amen. Before I said this, God taught me about rocks. Jesus was crucified on a rock. That rock was a big rock. He was buried in a rock. And had a rock put over the tomb. He's called the Rock of Ages, by the way. He's called the stone that the builders rejected, amen. He told the scribes and Pharisees that these people don't praise me, the rocks will be cried out. Joshua told the people after he gave him a lecture, he said, you better do what I told you. You're in trouble. He said, if you don't, see this rock right here? See this rock right here? Can everybody see this rock right here? He said, this rock will testify against you. I know that the mountains break forth in the sea. The trees clap their hands. Come on, amen. All of the earth responds. Listen, the earth is waiting for a manifestation of the sons of God. The earth wants us looking for praise God. Well, I said, Lord, where's this outcry coming from? He said, the earth is crying out. It's growing. And it was growing into a failure because of the wickedness of these things. And he said, the earth was crying out for justice. You know, God is a judge of all the earth. Several months ago, the Lord said, I want you to study that. Now, this would have been 10 years ago before we had, well, maybe longer than 10, but I didn't have a computer 10 years ago. I would have had to do it to the Psalms recordings. But thank God for the computer, I could do it my pastor. I said, if every scripture in the Bible that talked about the throne of God, and God blew me away, I never realized the position of God that He holds over all creation. You see, you have to understand, when you get a hold of this, you realize why your prayers are so important. Why God needs intercessors. The Supreme Court only makes decisions on the cases that are brought to them. Is that true? If God is a judge, and Abraham declares it here, just a few verses we're going to read, he calls him a judge of all the earth. God judges what is brought to His attention. And see, when sin begins to build up, the earth itself will cry out to him. The rocks will cry out. He said, well, I don't know if I'll bring that up. I'm sorry. But, I mean, you know, the sign in the world was destroyed with rocks, on fire rocks. Yeah. And see, this is what was happening. God said, I've heard you. I'm the judge. I've got a family seat. They're worthy of judgment. What did Abraham do? Yeah. Well, the first thing he did, essentially, he stood before the Lord. And Abraham came near. Well, verse 22 says, Abraham still stood before the Lord. And Abraham came near and said, would you also destroy the righteous with the wicked? Suppose there were 50 righteous within the city, would you also destroy the place and not spare for the 50 righteous that were in it? Far be it from you to do such a thing, to slay the righteous with the wicked, so that the righteous should be as the wicked. Far be it from you, shall not the judge of all the earth do right? Yes, he will. But he needs an intercession. You see, all of a sudden, it makes sense how Jesus saved us. We were worthy to be punished for our sin. Jesus. And God did it. See, nobody could get to the throne. Nobody had ever ascended into heaven to Jesus. And he ascended into heaven. I mean, he took his brother. The Bible says, I don't know how he did it, but it says he did it. And he appeared before God. Judge of all the earth gave a pardon to whoever calls on the name of the Lord would be saved. Wow. The judge of all the earth. Now, how many know he's still the judge? And we need to realize that we got to be like Abraham. God will always do what's right. You know, I hear these people talk about the sovereignty of God. About it, but he has restricted himself to certain things. Amen? Without faith, it is impossible to please him. If you want to please God, you've got to have faith. Come on, amen? Why is he that way? Because faith means you know what his will is. Righteousness delivers from see, it's how I miss when the children of Israel came out of Egypt, and here's where kind of we are in spirit, but the truth right now. The cloud of God is moving. But the church, for the most part, isn't it? There are those in power. But I don't know if you were with the group that came out of Egypt and the cloud moved and said, I'm staying here. I mean, Pharaoh's army would have got you. You wouldn't have been there when the sea opened up. And then it would have closed and you'd come later and say, well, I'm not going to get across. You've got to stay with the cloud. And see, God's moving right now and he's trying to get us in a place so that when the glory comes, you can handle it. He wants to use you in your lives. Hallelujah. Had a lady healed at Walmart while back. She got healed so excited. Her friend of her friends walked by. She grabbed her and said, you got to get this picture from her. She started talking to her. And she said, I'm going to heal with this. She said, would you like us to pray for you? She said, sure. Go back to sleep. Pray for her. She's about to fell over and knocked the pharmaceutical out of. She said, woo, I haven't felt God like this in years. In Walmart. No matter where you're at. Amen. Hallelujah. It's just God to open up doors. jug of all the earth to be in our face. I think for the most part, we don't realize what's happening in our country because it's been such a bad thing. Now I was born in 1950, so I've seen a lot of the changes in America. But in the days that needed to be were gone. Come on, Indian. And you know, in the days of world riders with a Sodom and there was no blood, they no longer live there. They fight. They hit 100 times and they just got back. Got a 6-year to shoot at 20 rounds. Yeah. You know, those days are gone. Now they got something on TV. Oh, man. Why did they cut them all up? Pull their brain out and said, I know, I'll be bad. Just tell them. What's happened? We become desensitized. Come on, amen. Get exposed to stuff like that and become desensitized. You don't realize it. The things that took blood, they get desensitized. And that's why violence is going to increase before Jesus comes back. I'm amazed that it increased more than that. I'm just very fortunate that that's another verse. But when hard economic times come, we're going to find out what's happening. Yeah, he says, look at Isaiah 24. Look at verse number 4. The earth mourns. You could say wrong. Same word. Fades away. The earth languishes and fades away. The haughty people of the earth language. You know how you can tell a haughty person when they say they know how to fix it. Hello? I don't know if anybody can fix it. That's the politician. I'm waiting for somebody who's running for office to say, you know what, we've got ourselves in a terrible mess. And the only thing I'm going to do is we need to get back to God. Not this program, but that program. And none of them will work without God. Amazingly. The earth is also defiled. It's corrupted under its inhabitants. Because they have transgressed the laws and changed the ordinance and broken the everlasting covenant, therefore the curse has devoured the earth and those that dwell in it are desolate. There is no good. It's sin that causes the curse to increase. Verse number 19, same chapter. The earth is violently broken, the earth is split open, earthquake. The earth is shaken exceedingly, the earth is shall leap to and fro like a drunkard. And shall potter like a plant. Its transgression shall be nothing upon it. And it shall fall and not rise again. And I will put it for the season until Jesus comes. This is speaking about the last day. That what happens in this last day will not be fixed until Jesus comes. Amen. Now, I said, Lord, I said, what's in our, where's how should we believe? He said, Psalm 91. You read Psalm 91. In fact, it's so bold that it says, those that have made, listen to this, that have made the Lord, the Most High, their habitation. In other words, it's something you did on purpose. Consciously did. Therefore, no evil shall befall them. Not only a little evil. No, it says no evil. Come on, amen. They shall all be but for life, but so-and-so. Let's be Christian. I don't judge the word of God. looks like it's not working. I don't say, well, I guess I promised I'm a part of it. You've heard a campaign. You know, when he was healed at the age of 16, he had three incurable diseases that he was supposed to die. And when he did, God healed him. He went to church, his church, his pastor, who did not believe in him, thought those days had passed away, said, listen to this, that even though the doctor was in the church confirmed that it was a miracle, said that Brother Nathan had been in bed so long he could not believe this. And that he wasn't really healed. He wasn't really healed. He was delirious because he'd just been in bed so long. And he probably followed the dead he'd become. Now that, sad to say, that pastor was very much disappointed. Because Brother Nathan didn't follow the dead. All the time he preached the gospel, amen. Because God will use you. Unbelief is such an ugly thing. Especially when I suppose you're trying to find some way to get around. Well, I don't have any power because God doesn't do it to you. Right? I hope that's good. Praise God. Look at chapter 26. Verse 8. This is how I'm going to tell us how to go to God. Verse 8 says, in your way, the way of your judgments, O Lord, we have waited for you. The desire of our soul is for your name and for the remembrance of you. With my soul, I have desired to remain. Yes, by my spirit within me, I will seek. For when your judgments are in the earth, the inhabitants of the world will learn righteousness. We bring the righteous judgments of God. When we look at our country and we look at what's happening, God can change it. And he needs us seeking him to bring his righteous judgments on the earth. Sometimes, you know, you ever wonder why the wicked seem to get away with it? Because we're not crying out. Now, we're not allowed to judge him. Matthew chapter 7, verse 1 says, judge not, lest you be judged. So, but we. God, we need your judgments to come into the earth. We need you to come and judge the evil that's in the earth. But also remember when Abraham said, Lord, will you judge the righteous with the wicked? I mean, the judgment first begins in the house of God. God's wanting us, you know, how can God go judge the world when he's not dealing with us first? And you know what, if I'm going to one thing right here, it's 4 point, or 3 point back in the weeks. Is that right? So we have to get rid of all of them. And have a pure heart before God. That's what he wants, amen? Let me tell you something. God wants to turn America around. The whole blueprint of this last day is in the book of time. Starts from the hard times. Difficult times. Then they go into a prayer. Let the priests weep between the courts of the altar. And then all of a sudden, this mighty army comes. Then God pours out the blessing. He pours out the Holy Spirit. And the gospel gets preached. And all of a sudden, in the last chapter of Job, is the battle of Armageddon. So salvation did come from the last time. Amen. And it's beginning. You want next year is going to be a year that we've never seen. And we need to be like the five. got in your car and you're going a long trip and you're looking at the tank almost all in. And you know you better stop. Or you will stop. Stop on purpose, huh? Yeah. And see, that's what you've got to do. You've got to recognize God already answered your question. You know, just get by that. Those are the ones that went in when the cloud came. They heard, they could hear the voice. They heard the voice of the God from the cloud. And they remembered those things. You see, as things get tough, you will be tested in ways you've never been tested before. I know that's not exactly. But at the same time, we're going to see God do things we've never seen him do before. In our generation, beyond, God certainly, he said, everything you do is just because you couldn't believe it. You couldn't believe it. He said, but it will come into the church that this is it. The final curtain, the final curtain. And in that, we were set out to him. In fact, there is that cloud right now for us to set out to him. Amen. And you know, when I was a kid, I was raised in a church that was kind of what you call a holiness church. My mom wasn't allowed to go to the room. But my wife would stay in that church in the room. You know, dresses had to be below the knees, no bare arms. And you know, I would make a kind of that, honestly, mom. Because I'm sure it came from a heart desire of people that wanted to be holy. And then somehow, you know, it passed down to us. And all we saw was dress clothes. You know. But if the spirit of it could have been passed to us, the spirit of us. See, everything gets lost on us. Each generation. And so God will never pass the pure faith that each generation has had built upon. And one more thing. Just a couple more verses we'll be done. In Isaiah 26. Let's see. Verse 2. Let grace be shown to the wicked, yet he will not learn righteousness in the land of the uprightness. He will deal unjustly. Let me know if we have that thing. We have a land that is full of blessings. I remember some years ago I was in New York, and our kids were still little then, and we went over to, since we were so close, we went to see the Statue of Liberty. We couldn't go in because they were remodeling the buildings. And I looked across New York Harbor and I saw the Twin Towers. Took a picture of them. Very beautiful. The biggest, tallest thing. You know what they represent? Double portion of someone's passion. And I mean, they're not there. They can never. God is dealing with them. Right now. He's going to bring it to a place that we can be told in how we can come. Now, I want you to tell me, because I can't get that time. Judgment, and it's coming in the form of chastisement. I mean, it's one thing to chastise somebody rather than to kill them. God is going to kill them with the chastisement. And he said there will become a prayer revival after that. Then will come a visitation from heaven. Then the gospel will be preached in the heart. I saw a prayer revival coming through there. And I said, God, why? You know, I was listening to Lester so long. He's been dead for 7 years. I love the way that you think. You and his teeth are right. And he was talking about a revival that's going to be beyond anything we've ever seen. I said, God, you talked about it. Brother Hank and others talked about it. Where is it? He said, he said, if I give you power, he said, what that which is of the world in me will try to rise up and take hold of that. I'm going to hurt you. I said, God, that's never a fun thing, is it? If you hurt you, he said, all the world will do success. He said, I'm hurting my church. He said, you're going to have to turn to me and trust me. And he said, I'll wrestle with this mind. He said, the revival will begin with people on the didn't leave their bodies, they left their bodies, they went up to